Hi there everybody, let's talk about the new Mazda CX-60, but in a diesel trim. Actually, it's not a trim. The trim is named Takumi because it has a white leather interior, which mimics that cork material that Mazda used to make back in the 1900s. But I personally think it also resembles a kimono, you know, the Japanese classic dressing for the clothing that warriors used to use. And I think it's a really premium, nice interior, but I don't think we should talk about, I don't know, cup holders, seat clothing and lots of normal things that you can see in the photos. And I think that you already know, because you've probably seen videos and photos of this car. I want to talk about the engine and the experience of driving it. I've been using this car for about 3 days now. This is my last day and I have to return it to the dealership. And I already had another two versions of this car in a plug-in hybrid configuration, which had a difference only in trim level. The first one was a Takumi, identical with this one, like full option, as we say here in Romania. And the second one was in a Homura level, which means basically the same thing but in a different color. The Napa leather is black, and I personally like this interior more because it's more it creates more light from my point of view, and because the car also has a sunroof, additional light comes inside, and it's a truly nice interior. It resembles a home because it's so full of light. And you get this car around the world in many different configurations. Actually, Mazda has an interesting future ahead, I think, and they had a lot of courage to launch 4 vehicles with many different configurations and engines. Actually, they developed a new longitudinal engine mounting and rear-wheel drive architecture, which also has all-wheel drive options like this one I'm driving right now. And as you may know, many of the Mazdas, all actually, for about 10 years now, they have been transverse engine and front-wheel drive with all-wheel drive options, but they were front-wheel drive bias. So, I don't know, we could call them generically a Haldex style car. Although they do not use Haldex traction couplings, more they use Toyota couplings, JTECT, exactly like this car. And the thing is that they moved away from this layout because they wanted to step up and join the premium side of automobiles. I think they want to compete directly with Mercedes-Benz, with Audi and BMW. And they had to raise the price because this car is way more complicated than a normal Mazda was before. But it has its small drawbacks, which I will try to cover in this video. Mainly, the differences are mechanical and regarding the size of the vehicle. Because you can see that it has grown in exterior size, but sadly not in the interior size. If you compare it with a CX-5, it is virtually longer, it's a bigger car, but the interior space, especially the boot and the back seat area, is almost the same, if not a little bit smaller than the CX-5, which is kind of a pity for the exterior size of the car. But at least you get multi-link suspension in the rear with 5 arms and a double wishbone setup in the front. And you get longitudinal engines, rear-wheel drive or all-wheel drive, with a longitudinally mounted transmission with 8-speed, without a torque converter. This is quite interesting. And basically, this new architecture has about 4 new models, but some of them are still transverse engine, like the Mazda CX-50, which is actually a 7-seater version of the CX-30. And if I remember well, this is the CX-30 in the front, for example. So you get a longer version of this one, and you also get a longer version of the Mazda CX-5, which is called CX-8, still a transverse tangent. But you get this new kind of vehicle with rear-wheel drive longitudinal engine, like the CX-60. There will be a three-row seater version called CX-80. And outside of Europe, you'll get CX-70 and CX-90, which will be larger than this car. The CX-90 has already been launched in USA, and it is a 7-seater, 345 horsepower animal. So you can compare it easily with a BMW X5 or Mercedes GLE in that kind of mechanical, I don't know, luxury style. I've seen a review of it on YouTube, on an American channel, so I think it will be the only place where I will see it, unless I will travel to the United States again. I've been there in 2011. But for sure, if nobody imports one of that model through Russia, Ukraine, Republic of Moldova, I won't be seeing it here live. And all these vehicles come equipped with new variants of engines. All of them have a base 2.5 Skyactiv-G, which is a 4-cylinder naturally aspirated engine that is an existing engine. It has been used for a while on CX-5, for example, or on Mazda 3. And basically, it is a evolution of the Mazda L engine, which was financed by Ford. And also the Mazda L engine is the basis of Ford's EcoBoost lineup of engines. You may remember the CX-7, which had a 2.3 turbo engine, which was direct injected and turbocharged 265 horsepower. And the EcoBoost that, for example, the Ford Mustang uses is exactly like that engine in specifications, shape, but it's not the same engine. Ford has a custom head on it. Only the block is kind of different, so they don't have interchangeable parts. But it is interesting that Ford financed that engine, and also Ford financed a lot of diesel engines from the former PSA group. For example, the diesels, the HDIs, 1.6, 1.5 and 2 liter diesel were made by French in collaboration with Ford, actually with Ford's money. And also Ford developed those 3.6, 4x4, 2.7 and 3.0 V6 and V8. So that is the history of their lineup of engines. And actually Ford now uses the Mazda L engine on the Ford Kuga plug-in hybrid or hybrid. You get them in USA named as, I think, Ford Escapes there. And that engine is an existing engine, naturally aspirated, 192 horsepower. So they took that engine in two configurations. In Japan, for example, you can buy this car as a normal 2.5 aspirated, which is the cheapest version. Then in Europe, for example, we get it as a plug-in hybrid. That same engine is coupled to a transmission that has a 100 kilowatt electric motor, which means about 136 horsepower. And that motor is integrated with two clutches in the transmission instead of a normal torque converter. So the whole car has a power of 327 horsepower and about 620 newton meters, if I remember well, or 500. I don't remember exactly. I think 500 although. And that car is all-wheel drive with a central coupling made by JTECT. It's interesting that all-wheel drive coupling is the exact one you find in the Toyota Yaris GR. So it's the exact same system, but as you may see, it is mounted centrally, not in a rear wheel drive configuration as the Yaris GR. So you have that all-wheel drive coupling in the center of the car, not in the rear. It is the exact same unit adapted to run an all-wheel drive system which has a longitudinal transmission. So basically the car will always be rear wheel drive, and from that shaft you get a chain with a multi-plate coupling that can send additional torque and power to the front of the car. So it behaves just like, for example, an X-Drive from BMW without having a center differential. It's very important to cover that. So it is a permanent all-wheel drive, but it is a hang-on system. So only when necessary, it will send all the cap torque to the front of the car. So this is the basic configuration. This engine, 2.5 is a good engine as it is in small and medium cars, but I don't find it proper as a, an engine for this car because it weighs almost 2 tons. It is a large car and you need to drive it like more spirited. And that 4-cylinder engine is not that refined from my taste. So they didn't stick to this configuration, which I think it's wonderful, because they got to build another architecture of engines, which is inline 6, both gasoline and both diesel. And you get many configurations. Basically, the start point was the 4-cylinder 2-liter lineup of Skyactiv X. You know that engine they make, which is kind of a diesel that runs on gasoline. So it has a very high compression ratio. It has direct injection, but controls the this part of combustion through spark. So it's called SPCCI, spark control compression ignition. I won't get into the details because this car does not have that engine yet. So basically that 2-liter Skyactiv X engine was upsized by adding 2 cylinders. So it will be a 3-liter, around 286 horsepower, in the identical style of functioning, the same compression ratio, piston shape and development. As I've heard, it may not use a supercharging compressor because being a larger engine, it will have sufficient air in the intake, so it doesn't need supercharging, but we'll see, because the engine hasn't been launched yet. I haven't seen a test anywhere with it. So this will be one of the engines supplied in Europe, for example. But the interesting part is they made a 3.3 engine, both gasoline and diesel, by using the internal measurements of the 2.2 Skyactiv diesel. So the same bore and stroke and general appearance of the engine has been upscaled to obtain a 3.3 diesel, which is set up at around 200 or 254 horsepower, 450 or 550 newton meters, and they also made the 3.3 gasoline that has the exact bore and stroke values, but uses a different cylinder head with a pentroof combustion chamber, not a flat one like the diesel, and it has a slightly lower compression ratio. For example, the old diesel had 14:1 compression ratio. This one has 15:2. And that's because the shape of the piston crowns is completely different. The combustion chamber has a double egg shape inside, so it's completely different, and the engine has different parameters. But the 3.3 gasoline should be a conventional engine, no Skyactiv X technology or complicated lean burn stuff. It's just a direct injected gasoline, probably the same style of functioning as the 2.5 turbo engine you get in the States, which runs on regular or premium gasoline and develops around 231 to 250 horsepower. And because it is a 6-cylinder engine with a twin scroll turbocharger, it will develop between 286 and 354 horsepower. And this is the engine, for example, that the Mazda CX-90 has. Also, the CX-60 will have that engine, but now in a 260 horsepower form, and for sure not in Europe, because I don't know, they want to keep emissions down. And the interesting engine is this one, the diesel. You may know that manufacturers want to step away from diesel. They downsize the engine, they add more turbines or more boost. The engines keep getting smaller and smaller, even though the horsepower ratings increase. So you can see, for example, Mercedes' approach is that they use a 2-liter twin turbocharged diesel. Actually, it's a B-turbo with two different turbine shapes that develops almost 270 horsepower. But it's a 4-cylinder 2-liter. It is, I don't know, too pumped up, and it's not that refined. So you get the same power level at Mazda with a 6-cylinder 3.3 diesel, which comes in mild hybrid or standard forms. All of them are coupled to this new 8-speed torque converter-less transmission. So it uses a clutch pack and different sizes of electric motors that act as both starter, alternators, generators for the whole system. So this one here is a mild hybrid system. It has a 0.3 kilowatt hour battery, a 40 volt lithium ion battery. It also has a normal 12 volt lead acid battery. And the whole system behaves just like a normal mild hybrid. But the thing is that you don't have a belt alternator in the system. On that rubber belts, you will get only air conditioning compressor and water pump. The actual generator of the system is in the transmission, and it has two clutches. One can decouple the diesel engine from the whole transmission, and the other clutch can decouple the electric motor from the transmission, but using the first clutch, you can keep the electric motor as a starter and generator for the diesel engine, which is very interesting. But because it does not have a torque converter, sometimes it has some glitches and shakes when you, for example, drive at 100 kilometers an hour and you lift your foot off the accelerator, the engine will turn off. And as I found out by testing, I think that the restart of the diesel engine takes place through inertia and not through active turning of the electric motor. So basically, instead of starting the engine with the electric motor, the system just closes the clutch and you get a strong shudder when the engine restarts, especially, for example, you drive at a normal 2 to 3000 rev range in the tachometer, which is kind of annoying because, for example, BMW has a similar system, but it's better implemented. You don't get these shakes. Although it's quite refined, even if it's not a torque converter, when it comes to departing from a standstill. If you lift your foot off the brake and press the accelerator, the engine will start rather smoothly and you don't get those shakes. But sometimes when it downshifts, you get a lot of jerks that shouldn't be there in this kind of system. But I think it's a matter of calibration, which will take place in maybe 1 year from now, because, you know, all the manufacturers have recalls and software updates which should improve the running of these engines. And this diesel is very interesting because it is an engine of small values. They didn't want to make it powerful. Of course, if you add a software, you could probably easily get 300 to 350 horsepower, but this wasn't the idea. The idea was that they wanted a normal relaxed engine. So they just took the existing architecture, but the engine is totally different because you get the timing in the back. All 3 and 3.3 liter engines have the exact same timing, three chains, one for the oil pump and a two-stage chain for the camshafts. And in the middle stage, you get the fuel pump, both for gasoline, both for diesel. And it is a system that has already been used, and it is used for some time now in the Skyactiv X, the 2-liter four-cylinder engine, which has the timing chains on the flywheel side. So they just copied this system and implemented it here, both on the diesel and on the gasoline. And this exact same treatment has been done by Mercedes with their new lineup of six-cylinder engines and four-cylinder engines. So you can see OM656, which is a diesel, M256, which is a gasoline, both 3 liters, and their 4-cylinder little brothers, which are called OM654 for diesel and M254 for gasoline. They all use the same timing system layout. And this also applies here. And you will see that the timing does not use the variable system that the 2.2 used, which returns some of the burned gases inside the combustion chamber, because this system now only uses one turbine. 2.2 had two turbines, which were waste-gated with pneumatic actuators. This motor has a twin-scroll turbine with a head that has an exhaust manifold integrated in it, so it's exactly like a gasoline engine. A small twin-scroll turbo, which is bolted directly to the head of the engine. And it has a variable turbine geometry, which is motor electrically managed. And you also have two EGR system. You have a high pressure one, just like the 2.2 had. But the thing is that because you have the exhaust manifold integrated in the head, you don't have an external EGR gallery. So the exhaust gases are remain in the engine, but they come out of the combustion chamber. So it has a an internal passage that connects the exhaust manifold to the intake side of the manifold, where you find also the charge air cooler, because the intercooler is not air, it's air to liquid, and it is integrated inside the intake manifold. Actually, they sit one on top of the other, and they have also a special cooling circuit for that. So basically, you get that high pressure EGR with two valves, one that acts as a coolant bypass valve, and the other, which is the actual EGR valve. And the low pressure system takes the gases from after the post-treatment, so after the DPF and the catalysts and the whole filtration system on the exhaust, and returns those gases after they have been cooled at the intake of the turbine. So the high pressure connects the two galleries, and sadly it means that it will make some carbon deposits in the intake, and it's good for warming the engine up. But the base, actually the main system of EGR, will be the low pressure one, which takes the gases filtered and reintroduces them in the intake tract in the turbo, which means that you won't see any deposits from that system, and it's way more reliable. It does not affect the turbo pressure, and by using two EGR system, the engine is more relaxed. You get this twin scroll turbine, which separates the flow for two pairs of cylinders. 1, 2, 3 is one pair, 4, 5, 6 the other pair. They don't mix those gases. So this means that it will be more efficient. And because it has a 2,500 bar piezo injectors, they have been pumped up with 500 more bar pressure than comparing with the 2.2. It is a new injection method, because they use up to 9 sequences of injection, but actually in the daily use you'll see maximum 5 injections. And because you get that double egg shape combustion chamber, you can burn a lean mixture at top dead center way faster than before. So you are not dependent through time. You don't have to wait to inject more fuel. You just inject it in a shorter sequence. And because this system has a higher pressure, it will be more efficient. And talking numbers, for example, in Romania, we have a rather chaotic and crowded traffic. And now, since I've left home and you see the whole ride, the real fuel consumption is 7 liters per 100 kilometers. Yesterday, it was very crowded, because it was the end of the day and people returned home from work and from taking kids from school, and the consumption was about 9.6. Outside of town, if you drive slowly with 60-70 kilometers an hour, you'll see between 3.9 and 4.2, and if you drive more spirited, you'll see about 5 liters per 100 kilometers an hour. And driving it on the freeway, between 7.2 and 7.7 liters per 100 kilometers, driving at 140 kilometers an hour. And if you just drive the car from your house to a friend's house that lives in another city that is like 300 or 400 kilometers away, you'll probably obtain a fuel consumption of about 6.7 liters kilometers an hour. And the magic is that it's a big, relaxed engine. You don't get high taxes because it is a mild hybrid system. It does not smell like a normal diesel because it is very relaxed. But I wouldn't buy this engine for urban use, because it's still a diesel. It has complicated EGR systems, a very high pressure injection system, AdBlue, DPFs, and all sorts of catalysts. A gasoline engine is way more reliable and on the long term. But this system, I think, is more refined than the plug-in hybrid one, because it drives way smoother. It does not have all those jerks, but they should calibrate it more, because the car has a 5-arm multi-link suspension in the rear with some differences. For example, the all-wheel drive versions use uniball joints and have a stabilizer bar. Rear-wheel drive versions do not have a stabilizer bar, and one of the five pair of arms uses rubber bushings, so the whole suspension will be softer and more comfortable. Also, the rear final drive will be longer on rear-wheel drive versions. It's a small difference. It's like 4 versus 4.2 on plug-in hybrid versions or gasoline 2.5. And on all other versions, it will be between 3.15 versus 3.18 or 25, something like that. So, if you go rear-wheel drive, your revs will be lower on the same speed. If you drive, for example, at 120 kilometers an hour, this all-wheel drive will have 750 RPM, and the rear-wheel drive will probably have 1600, something like that. The thing with this system is that the rear suspension is extremely bouncy. The car is like an MX-5, it's very rigid in some situations, especially when you drive on country roads that are not even. And if you drive with a small child that is sleeping in that baby chair, I think he will wake up and he will cry and you will get nervous. So they should calibrate this system more. Also, the car has some errors regarding the fuel consumption on the plug-in hybrid. It estimates bad the fuel consumption and the electric current consumption. And I think that they will have some recalls for that. The car already has recalls to reprogram four of its functioning computers that manage the car systems. And also you get some squeaks. The boot has some rubber bushings that cannot be adjusted. And when you go on rough roads, you will hear a rattle, which many people mistake by thinking that is a rattle of the back seats. But actually it's the actual boot that does this. It's not annoying because you only hear it if you drive without music, like I'm doing right now. And also the car has a very direct steering, which is nice, but sometimes at fast driving you feel the necessity to compensate, to do small corrections, but the car is, I think, very stable for that. The all-wheel drive functions well, but it is not a 4x4, so you don't have to drive it like a Toyota Land Cruiser, because you will overheat that system. Never drive the car on off-road mode on pavement, only on wet roads and, I don't know, snow and stuff like that, because you will damage that central coupling, and that coupling will anyway probably turn off by itself, leaving the car rear-wheel drive if you exaggerate. So you have a sport and normal mode, and the car does really have a punch. It has about 7.2 seconds not to 100 kilometers an hour, and 100 to 200 kilometers an hour about 21 seconds. So it drives just about like an X330D, which has about 265 horsepower, or an X530D with 286 horsepower. It has a small acoustic update because you can hear a different engine in the speaker system, but anyway, the whole engine has a nice rumble, especially if you drive it hard. If you drive it slow like this here, you won't get any weird sounds from it, and you can swear that it is an electric car. This is very silent, and I don't know, I will always prefer large engines with multi-cylinder configurations. That's because it's an inline six, it's perfectly balanced. And the car is very comfortable, although the seats are rather hard and they are rather short for tall people, especially the area where you sit. And the paddle shifters have a small amount of lag. It's just a programming stuff. The transmission shifts good, but I think it's calibrated to be smooth, not fast. For example, a ZF8 HP transmission shudders a lot when you put it in sport, which is what people want. This kind of transmission is very smooth. Sometimes it acts like a normal CVT, I think. You don't feel the gear changes, except when you get that i-stop, start-stop system that turns off the engine when you drive the car normally. It should enter just about now, depends on road conditions, for example. Now the transmission coasts. When you push the accelerator pedal, it just resumes the engine functioning without any shudders. And also the braking system is very good. It is Continental MKC1, which is a brake-by-wire system, the exact system used on Alfa Romeos, BMWs, Volvos and Fords, which actually has a brake pedal that is a simple switch. You don't control the actual brake pressure directly mechanically, but electromechanically through a computer, and it's very, very well calibrated, and the stopping times are far shorter than a normal system. But you don't feel that regen brake which uses the motor. For example, when you brake hard, the engine gets decoupled or maybe turned off, and after that you will feel the transmission shifting because it downshifts from, I don't know, 8 to second speed, for example, by having the electric motor coupled, and it regenerates the battery with it. But it isn't a proper engine brake because the engine is decoupled or turned off. So it's very interesting. It can coast, it can brake by using regen, and it can also brake by using the actual engine brake, and you can brake by using hydraulic pressure. And this all gets controlled through the computer that the brake pedal, I don't know, manages. And this is kind of a bumpy road here, but the car has a very good stance, so it behaves just like a rear-wheel drive Mazda MX-5, but you have to add the proportions because it's a 2-ton car and it's way higher than an MX-5. And sadly, the seats aren't that sporty, so you get thrown a lot around the chair. The car is quite stable, but you are not stable in the seat. This is the difference. And I think that just about wraps things up. It is my first explanatory video that it is so long, and I hope you understood what I wanted to transmit, and maybe in the future I will try to refine the speech style. But I wanted to deliver my first impressions, start stop, of this new engine that Mazda has made, because I think they were very, very courageous to invest a lot of money in a new configuration of inline six engines with four different models of cars. When everyone goes electric and downsizes, they made diesels, gasolines, small cars, big cars that have rear wheel drive. So I think we should give them some credit and be gentle with them, because it is a new platform that hasn't yet to be tested a lot. So maybe after 1 year from now, you'll get to see improvements regarding these shutters of the transmission and things related to functioning of the mild hybrid and plug-in hybrid system. All in all, I think it is an interesting engine and made especially for longer roads, and you just drive in perfect harmony with it. And this is Mazda. It is a company that builds harmony. The Jim Baita, you get one with the car, the rider, one with the horse. It's a saying they have, and I think it is a very interesting approach. But at least it's different. You don't have to copy everyone else. You have to do it in your way. But sometimes it's good to copy, because you don't have to invent the wheel again if it already has been invented. So tell me what you think about this car. How many of you own these vehicles? I would be gladly interested to hear some feedback about the 3.3 gasoline engine that has been launched in the USA, anyway, outside of Europe. And I hope people that got interested about the diesel got to find out here the interesting details they have. Bye-bye.